Hello. In today's video, we will talk about the features you can find in the Accelerometer Features tab in the Teltonika Configurator. The first feature you will see after opening this tab is the Excessive Idling feature, which allows us to detect if the driver has the engine turned on but is not moving. The feature monitors the ignition and movement sources, and if the ignition is detected without movement for a defined period of time, an excessive idling event is sent to the server. The whole feature logic is pretty basic, just the movement and ignition sources have to be configured correctly. If one of the selected movement sources is ignition, the excessive idling will never be detected. Next feature we will talk about is the unplug detection. Using the internal battery, this feature allows us to inform the user in case the device was disconnected from the external power source. This feature also has two modes, simple and advanced. In simple mode, the device will simply detect unplug event if the external voltage drops below 5.25 volts, while in the advanced mode, the device also monitors the accelerometer data and only creates unplug, even if the voltage drop happens together with movement. The advanced mode is especially useful for OBD devices, which are usually mounted in visible locations, and when they are unplugged, the voltage drop will always happen together, allowing us to detect only real unplug events, rather than just detecting voltage drop, which could happen due to OBD port power being turned off by vehicle ECUs or the battery being disconnected during vehicle repairs. Going forwards, we will see towing detection feature, which alerts the user when the vehicle is being towed away. The feature uses accelerometer to detect movement and to calculate the angle difference, which happens when the vehicle is lifted before towing. When it comes to other configurable options, we have activation timeout, which defines the time it takes for the towing monitoring to be activated after the ignition is turned off. This is implemented to allow the driver to turn off the ignition and leave the vehicle, as otherwise driver movement inside of the vehicle could trigger a towing event. Next option is event timeout, which allows us to configure for how long the angle and movement have to be detected in order to trigger a towing event. This allows us to filter out false towing detections when driver is getting into the vehicle or vehicle is moved by wind. Next, we can set up the force threshold for vehicle movement and angle that have to be reached in order for the towing event to be generated. These two parameters also work with the duration parameter, which allows us to configure for how long the angle and/or force has to be detected for the towing event, adding another filtering option to prevent false towing events. It is recommended that with this feature, the digital output would be connected to either vehicle alarm system or horn, informing the people nearby about the towing attempt. Depending on configuration, the device can also switch the data acquisition rate to moving, that way allowing the user to see where the vehicle is located more accurately. Last feature we will talk about today is crash detection, which allows us to detect crash events and also collect information before and after the crash using crash trace function. That way, allowing users to reconstruct the crash and see exactly how the crash happened and what kind of forces were endured during the crash. The configuration of the crash detection is pretty basic, with two configurable options of duration and force threshold. It is again pretty difficult to say exactly what the user has to set here, but we should keep in mind that the heavier the vehicle is, the more time it takes for it to slow down, meaning that the forces will be lower. Lighter vehicles, on the other hand, tend to slow down much faster, so the forces will be higher. As mentioned before, a very important part of the whole crash detection feature is the crash trace functionality. By default, the full crash trace is enabled, which means that the device will send all accelerometer values detected before and after the crash event. With trace changes selected, the device will only send accelerometer data if the value changes during the set duration, so it would lower the amount of possible redundant data sent to the server. Additionally, we have trace filter, which allows us to filter out abnormal data from the trace, which could happen due to data collection at a very high rate. Then we can see crash counter parameter, which allows the device to count impacts during the crash event and send this information to the server. That way, adding another point information for the user to understand how the crash has happened. Next, we can configure the trace ODR, where ODR stands for output data rate. This parameter allows us to set how often data from the accelerometer should be collected. The default rate is 100 Hz, while the maximum possible ODR is 200 Hz. This means that the device would collect 200 accelerometer data points per second, which would lead to large amounts of data generated, but a higher detail for the crash reconstruction. Following that, we have two duration settings, where we can configure data duration before and after the crash from accelerometer and GNSS sources. For example, if we would set 10 seconds here for both GNSS and accelerometer durations, once a crash event happens, the device will save in total 20 seconds of accelerometer and GNSS data. So we would see how the vehicle was moving before, during, and after the crash. The GNSS data is sampled once a second. So during crash, reconstruction, changes in vehicle speed and location will be visible.